RT Radio 1 Talking Proper, a series about how we use English in Ireland today.
Hello and welcome to the programme. I've had a bad week. That is to say, I've had a really good week. But for many young people in Ireland today, bad means good. And it is all because of this song. Popular music has always influenced the way we speak, but more so in the last few decades, as records became cheap and radio stations broadcast music 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Now, to talk about the influence of music on our language, I'm joined by Shay Healy, singer, songwriter, broadcaster, and of course, Eurovision winner, and Eamon Carr, who writes about music for the Evening Herald, and who also has a history as a musician in Horslips and the Zen Alligator. So, let's get rockin'. Eamon, we've been listening to Michael Jackson, I'm Bad. Could you say something now, please, about the influence of Black American English on the English of everyday life?
Well, I could comment on the track and say that, in fact, it is dope, or indeed, it's fat, or possibly better again, wicked. And I think these are all words that have come to mean brilliant or good or exceptionally good. And they're all words that would have come from sort of Afro-American culture. And I think that, you know, Black music currently, or urban music, if we want to call it that, or rhythm and blues, is a great source and a great repository of vernacular. And I suppose it has its origins in jazz, and well, going back to slavery, essentially, when people devised a language, as we would say in Ireland, that the stranger did not know.
So it was a code.
And it was a code. And then, you know, it came through jazz. I mean, the word jazz itself obviously had sort of sexual connotations, as indeed did the words rock and roll. I mean, rock and roll denoted a sexual activity.
Indeed.
And I think the American, the conservative rump in America, who in the 50s, around the time of Elvis Presley and so on, who were smashing the records and saying that this rock and roll music was going to change society, and as they knew it, were absolutely right, not just in terms of fashion and culture, but also in terms of language. And because the rock and roll language that came over the airwaves back in the 50s, a lot of it was taken from Black American experience. And Elvis Presley, of course, famously was the white boy who the record producer felt sang like a Black man.
Who dyed his hair.
And indeed he dyed his hair.
A Black man.
Yes. And he had, you know, he had access to, because he was from Tupelo and then Memphis, he had access to all of the phrases that Black people use. And he found them exciting and cool.
Cool, or as in modern Dublin now, they say coolabula.
Yeah, cool.
But what I want to ask, though, is they're cool, all right, but how is it that they influence people's thought? Because we can listen passively to vocabulary and say it's subversive, but how has it influenced the way people think about things? Because that's the key element, isn't it?
Well, if I understand you correctly, I think the answer would be that adolescents had access to a language that the adults didn't understand, and then they were part of a club, and they were part of an elite society. It was back in the 50s, it was a teenage society. And so their own language was devised, not necessarily by them, but for them. And indeed, some of the people who actually sort of wrote those songs were, you know, maybe sort of Jewish college graduates like Lieber and Stoller or whoever it might be. And suddenly people are going around talking about hound dogs and blue suede shoes and bopping and rocking at the high school hop and one thing and another. But curiously, a lot of those words, like sort of going for a bop, I mean, I hear my aunts and my uncles are at weddings or whatever using that expression now. And they certainly wouldn't have been using it in the 50s.
I see. So words then have lost their power now. They're less influence than they used to be.
They've been superseded.
In terms of their etymologies.
Well, I suspect they've been superseded by another set of words, because youth culture is forever changing. So the words that perhaps excited teenagers, or that teenagers felt that with their property in the 50s. As they grew older and as older people began to use them, then I think you find that that sort of another generation came along with a whole new set of words and a whole different covert language.
So can you think of any examples?
Well, I mean, there's expressions like, you know, see you later, alligator. People just throw that in. You know, rocking and bopping at the high school hopper. You know, too much monkey business, Chuck Berry.
So but let's have some examples then, shall we?
Indeed.
One, two, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. But you should glad to brag so far.
So we've been talking then about Ebonics or Black American English and the huge influence that had on international vernacular. Now, Shay Healy, Ireland has become, since the 50s or more recently, much more powerful as an influence on world music. Can you say something now about the international quality of Irish music and then the Irish quality of Irish music?
Well, to speak about the international quality of Irish music, you have to refer to you two who are the supreme exponents of Irishness in the international arena. And phrases like, I still haven't found what I'm looking for, have entered the popular vernacular. And as Eamon was pointing out, it is the function of each generation to reject the one that went before. And generally, the best way to do that is through your language. So, latterly, people like the Corrs are starting to, again, spread this message of Irishness through language, through the force and power of the lyrics, which tend to reflect a traditional Irish thing in that they always have a strong narrative, which you don't find a lot in other popular cultures. They tend to write abbreviated hooks, abbreviated choruses. I remember Bruce Shields explaining to me how you should write a song. He said, I'll tell you what you do. You write a verse and a chorus, and then you throw away the verse, and you make the chorus the verse, and you write the chorus of the chorus, and then you have your song. And it makes perfectly good sense. But I think that in modern Irish music, we are also reflecting the tremendous kind of cultural growth that we've experienced certainly in the 90s, and the way we've embraced other cultures in a way that we've never done it before, because they are starting to come here in greater numbers. I mean, there is a bigger diversity of available music in Ireland now than has ever been in my lifetime.
You mentioned the Corrs, and you also mentioned U2, Bono. Do you feel when you're listening to them that you've got an Irish voice singing, like the use of th, th, or sh, or film, orum, and all the other things? Do we have then a conversion from the speech of Irish people into the singing voices of Irish people, or do they denationalize themselves when they're singing?
We denationalize ourselves, and we did from the very beginning. I mean, the first time I think the natives got a crack at American music was in the showband era, and the showbands were pastiche. They copied note for note and phrase for phrase what they heard on the records coming from America. And they naturally enough, they mimicked the accents they heard the songs in. So that was the beginning of it. And then the same thing, I think, happened with rock music. But of course, there's always been individual voices like Phil Lynott and Thin Lizzy stood out as a very defined Irish voice that was unmistakable.
Let's have a listen then to Thin Lizzy.
Change had much to say, but man, I- found. Told them you were living downtown, driving all the old men crazy. The boys are back in town.
So could you just analyse for a few minutes the boys are back in town and tell us how that is so Irish?
Well, I suppose it expresses a kind of colloquial celebration of all the lads who might have grown together and broken up and gone their separate ways, reconverging maybe at a weekend or at a set place in a set time. So it evokes the whole camaraderie of Philip's own background in Crumlin. He would come in from Crumlin into the centre of Dublin, and he would go to clubs like the Five Club, and all the rockers, including Eamon Carr, they would all converge on the Five Club. So the boys are back in town. Whilst it was evoking a very Irish experience for Philip, I remember, in fact, Robbie Brennan, who played drums with him for a while in Grand Slam, he said, when Philip is in England, he's Irish. When he's in Ireland, he's from Dublin. When he's in Dublin, he's from Crumlin, and when he's in Crumlin, he's from Leglan Road.
Wonderful.
And that best explained Philip's. But Philip's experience has now gone out global. It's gone completely global in so much that the Boys Are Back in Town has come to represent an anthem everywhere in the world. It's played at all kinds of sports. It's played in a celebratory way all over the world. So the influence of the Irish language in that particular instance is supreme. We couldn't ask for a better example.
And also more recently with Sinead O'Connor.
Sinead, yeah. And I actually think that in singing her song, which was written by Prince, which primarily would have been a black song, she managed to imbue it with a whole Irish spirit and lifted it into the same kind of shade as the first time ever I saw her face, which was a folk song written by Ewan McCall. And she has managed to reimpose a folk voice on a lot of international songs.
Let's have a listen.
Eat my dinner in a fancy restaurant, but nothing, I said nothing can take away this blues, 'cause nothing compares to you.
So perhaps, Shay, you could say something about Sinead's voice there.
Perhaps Sinead's success has brought her back to where she started out from, which is brought her firmly back to Ireland. And her last album was a collection of Irish folk songs, which she sings with extraordinary passion and with the kind of conviction that she has, kind of mad conviction that comes in bursts. And when she does something, she does it 100%. And I think that she has rediscovered her identity. And maybe that she had to go off and trawl the international shores and the international charts before she actually came back and said, I am what I am, I come from where I come from, and these are my songs, and these are the songs I want to sing.
Could I ask Eamon now, do you feel, or am I wrong, that black American singers are much more difficult to decode than Irish singers, not because of the accent, but because they are using this club language you mentioned before more extensively?
Well, yeah, well, current black American singers possibly, but I think the original rural blues tradition, was because it was an oral tradition, had much in common with Irish traditional and folk music, and structurally the lyrics had a sense of mystery, a sense of sort of willful insanity, if you like, a sense of menace, a sense of joy, and essentially the language of an oppressed people. But yes, today it's grown into something that is possibly very difficult for maybe people of a different culture to understand. There is a story I heard of the member of the boy band who was going into a nightclub, and he had his 16 of his friends with him. So they turned up at the door, and the doorman said, "Sorry, 16 of you in the guest list, I can't let you all in." And of course, this particular superstar sort of got very annoyed, and said, walked away, and then he came back and he pointed at the doorman and he says, "You're messing, these are my posse," he said, "this is my posse, you're messing with the wrong nigger." So the slight problem is he'd sort of slightly got it wrong.
Exactly.
And yet, on the other hand, I mean, that word, you know, pejorative word, when used by black artists, can be affectionate.
Of course,
And affirmative and,
yes.
And positive and so on. But the accent thing is a thing that sort of, you know, sometimes puzzles me as well. I mean, it's said about Mick Jagger, a man who, you know, created his career of singing the songs of black Americans. An engineer once said that Mick Jagger could, in the studio, and often did, try out certain songs in different regional American accents. And he also has, of course, a very good Mockney accent, which he does as well, a sort of a pantomime accent. And of course, Elton John is from Pinner, and yet he sometimes sounds as if he's from Alabama. And Sting is from Newcastle, and he can sound convincingly from Jamaica. And so Joe Cocker is from, you know, the Midlands.
Yeah.
And Sinead, I think Sinead has been sort of finding herself because her accent sort of has sort of gone a bit like a weathercock, sort of basically to all points on the compass.
So it's fashion and also a sense of the risque, sense of danger, which we get in black American English, which we have to exchange our own for in order to reach that level of effectiveness.
I think it's a fashion. I think it's fashion, and it is ultimately, yes, the sense of danger and a sense of, dare I say, cool, a sense of style, revolt into style, if you like.
Well, in fact, the word cool itself came from the American jazz situation in the 1940s.
Yeah.
And cool is hot.
It's good to hear Irish people saying they got their mojo working, which is from the lexicon of black voodoo America.
Indeed, yes.
Which made all of that terribly exciting, because frankly most of the time we weren't too sure what we were talking about. Hoochie coochie men and southern blind Willie McTell's Southern Can Mama. I mean, what was a Southern Can? We found out subsequently, I hope, and the Crawl and Kingsnake and all of that sort of stuff. It was all wonderfully exciting, but you know, there were similar motifs, if you like, in Irish Shannos, and I'm not too sure how, but certainly it resonated,
Sinead O'Connor has so effectively presented, hasn't she? The Shannos Nua.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, this is a strength that possibly will develop into a movement. A guy like Damien Dempsey, who started out singing with an extraordinarily strong Dublin accent, has also kind of tailored his voice now to suit his own songs. He used to sing only covers. As he started to write his own music, his voice is becoming his on a more individual basis, but it's still a very pronounced Dublin accent. And it may well be that this, as I say, this is the nascent period in a whole movement that will kind of leave Christy Moore behind and will be Christy Moore for 2020.
Mm-hmm. Let's listen to an example.
You know, listening to you talk about that, I was struck by how the Clancy brothers took Irish ballads and folk songs to America and in New York, where they were heard by millions of people, but also by Bob Dylan, who then assimilated as an enormous piece of blotting paper. He just absorbed everything, but he assimilated so much of the Clancy's and Irish ballads. And then recycled and regurgitated, and yet possibly the greatest wordsmith in popular music, and he threw in a word in Rainy Day Women, in stoned, everybody must get stoned, and I, you know, sillyly remembered the first time I heard it, I thought it might have been a biblical reference, because you know, in those days we got drunk, but I certainly had never heard stoned, and you know, now, I might get squiffy or tiddly or whatever it might be, But stoned is an international word, like taxi or hotel.
Dylan also gave us, of course, the phrase like a rolling stone, somebody who was feckless and rootless and whatever else. I think the other great thing that Dylan did was that in the 60s, he was the voice of protest. A hard rain's going to fall. Everybody knew what he was talking about. And the answer is blowing in the wind. And he robbed our Irish narrative form quite a lot. I mean, Eamon is right, he did rob from the Clancy brothers the structure and form of the Irish ballad and used it very successfully in songs like With God on Our Side, which was a straight lift from the Patriot Game.
Eamon, then, could I ask you, moving on then to the different genres of rock music and how we have different types of language related to the different genres?
The many genres of rock music are defined not just by musical styles and musical sounds and instrumentation, but also obviously by their own language. And so as blues would have fed into rock and roll, so too possibly would have country, and then country would have expanded and defined. You would have had mod version of urban soul in the 60s, and you would possibly have had reggae, of course. But I think one of the more fertile avenues would have been psychedelia in the 60s, when a whole new lexicon was open to us. Things like hippies and far out and you know, things like good vibrations, trippy, spaced out, a buzz, all these peculiar odd words that we weren't 100% sure where they were coming from, except perhaps maybe those people who were doing some sort of illicit business with psilocybin or whatever it was, they possibly understood. But there was a language, and intriguingly, it was the Beach Boys with Good Vibrations. And now today, then it became Good Vibes, and talking about vibes. And now I hear the word vibes used by politicians and newsreaders. And
it's become almost genteel now, hasn't it?
It has indeed. And of course, as it has, so we look to a whole other generation of musicians coming along with their language. And I, again, I go back to sort of say the language of hip hop, where people are talking about, you know, get your freak on and what's your flavour. And so there's a whole other language which we won't necessarily hear on the 6 o'clock news or in the Doyle just yet.
Yes.
It's brilliantly muscular, though, that the modern language is. And Eminem, Seamus Heaney is quite right when he says he's a poet of the streets. And it, a lot of the language is violent and angry, but it's just a means of expressing themselves. It's like a writer writing on paper to get his thoughts down and out of his head. And the effect of that eventually will come here. Eventually we will have Irish rappers who will rap not in the same style as the American black rappers, but in an Irish rap form. There's some way that this modern culture will permeate our own culture here.
Even though we're now moving into a much richer period, so what would be, if you like, the generating impulse to be rappish in Ireland now?
Well, I think the way that popular culture has gone and that it has made it appear possible that everybody can have a say in business. Celebrity is all now for everybody, and it's the aspiration of each and every one to be heard for his 15 seconds of fame. And they do believe it's possible, and a lot of them will find their route through music. And also, because it's now possible to have a recording studio in your bedroom at home, more and more people who were disenfranchised up to now have licensed to put their thoughts down and to disseminate it over the net as well. They don't have to go through the traditional routes of trying to find a record label. And this has empowered them in a way that they never believed would be possible.
And I think the great thing about, say, for example, hip-hop, which is very much a DIY musical form, it's an oral, it's based on language. And it doesn't matter where you're from. I think the first time I would have heard somebody rapping was a chap I met in a late night restaurant in San Francisco. I believe he had a gun, and he was very annoyed, and he said, "My name is Floyd and I'm annoyed because the man sent me to Vietnam." And he went on for the next 42 verses telling me his life story at gunpoint. But yet in Dublin you can go to any of the suburbs and there are people with aspirations, the people needing a voice, as you said, and they're finding it. So they are, if you, poets of the street, if you wish, and they're using a language that they understand and that their friends understand, and hopefully eventually it will get on the airwaves and we'll all understand it.
Indeed. Could I ask Shay then, as a composer now and a lyricist, whether when you're composing lyrics you yourself have been tempted at times to create a word?
I can't say I have. I would fall into the category of Lawrence Hart, who loved finding an odd rhyme, and I would certainly look for an odd rhyme if it was possible. But I found it very hard ever to write the word ain't into a lyric or put baby in a song, because they felt, for a long time, they felt alien. I don't feel that way anymore. And in fact, Paul Brady in The Island, he says that's not no way or whatever, something that was grammatically incorrect. But it sounds, it's all that is permissible anymore. But I still would be from the old school. I would still try and get my tenses correct, my grammar correct, and try and find the odd rhyme.
But would you sometimes take a long word and split it up, or a short word and split it up into different syllabic voices?
Well, you can get baby, you can stretch baby out over three or four syllables if you...
That's what I mean, yes. You wouldn't.
And the power of the song is remarkable. I mean, to go to my own experience with What's Another Year, this was a phrase I heard between two guys sitting on the bus in front of me, and they were discussing whatever to do with their lives, and I just heard a guy say, "What's another year?" I grabbed it, I appropriated it, and it has been reappropriated by people all again. It's just gone into the popular vernacular. It's a way of expressing themselves at the end of a resolution to some dilemma.
It's now a worldwide idiom.
A worldwide idiom, is that what I am?
That's what you are, a walking worldwide idiom. And on that happy moment of celebration, can I celebrate Eamon and celebrate you, and thank you both very much.
What's
Talking Proper was presented by Terry Dolan, author of The